Thank you very much to all presenters and to all participants for nice discussions. And now is the point that we could look in detail to some special topics. The first question is, have you special requests, special questions concerning grid impedance issues or grid impedance points from the audience? I see Mr. Baumiller raise his hand.
Yeah, one question. I think that was a discussion also with you. Is it sufficient to have an average impedance or not? And so I think this discussion in the opinion, because if we calculate in frequency domain, we assume we have a linear time invariant system. As we see with the impedance, with the sub-impedance, with the time, the system is not linear time impedance. How you still thinking that your mathematics you're using with working in frequency domain, who assume we have a linear time invariant system, are still valid, that you can use it? Or is it not the point that you say, oh, we are not sure if our mathematics still works?
It is a question to the whole audience or to me now?
To the whole audience or to the whole audience. Okay. Like I see also Marco Lissier, I think it is a good question also in his direction and to you, of course, and to others also.
Okay, then Marco, would you like to start? Your micro is off.
Maybe Gernot Palmer speaking from Exxon. Okay, yeah. If yeah, I look to the frequency area, let's say DC to 20 kilohertz, you can simply forget to work with constant impedances. We see the influence in this area is never linear. The second thing is there is always the influence from those parameters at several measurements. We also saw another thing which makes it more complicated, that some of the controllers are not linear. Mm-hmm. And concerning this, there are really, really difficulties, and it's simply impossible to speak about a constant frequency or a constant impedance over a certain area. Mm-hmm. Yes. And it's even more tricky. This was a question that I would like then to raise to the audience. Are there models available, let's say, how you, or ideas, how, let's say, impedance could be modeled over frequency?
And time.
I see Marco Lusier raised his hand. Please, Marco.
Yeah, so this was also at the end of my presentation, the question. I want, first of all, to highlight that from our side, we, at least from when I'm chair of Power Electronics, we did focus mostly on the building this system to impedance measurement system. It was quite a big challenge. It was 2 megawatt, and using this linear approach was quite complex. So we are not focusing a lot on the actually analyzing the result, because we come to this result only recently. And in this sense, it would be quite nice to use different approach, like our approach and the approach of Professor Schulz in the maybe in the same place. It would be nice to see how to compare them. As a matter of let's say indication, because we are active in a very different field in which similar approaches they are using, as is impedance spectroscopy for battery characterization. When you have chemical process, they are not also quite easy to handle. And there have been developed quite a number of approaches. So, but this is just an kind of intuitive thing. So I don't know if really some of them, they can be migrated to the analysis, because I fully agree that we are talking about an highly dynamical system. And so we are not talking about that, so remain statical, but the question is also which kind of information we need for our study. So if the goal is the stability, so in which so how stable should be this impedance value? Yeah.
Thank you much, Professor Lisier. Are there more contributions to this topic? Please, Professor Waffenschmidt.
Yeah, I have another topic, if I may ask, to the experts. Do you sometimes see resonances of the lines itself? So that means if you go to higher frequency, the length of the line corresponds to the wavelength or quarter wavelength. Can you see these effects in the measurements?
Yes, I could give this to the audience, but I could answer also firstly for myself. Of course, if you have the right measurement point at the end of a long line, especially at the end of long cable lines, then you can see, of course, resonances. And you can determine then in relation to the length of the cables and to the mix of the different consumers. Mm-hmm. Of course, that is visible. For me, it's an interesting question if the very detailed determination of the grid impedance over one period brings other results than the mean values measured with the devices. That is maybe a question to Mr. Stiegler. What is your opinion? If you presented a lot of different impedance curves for household devices and other devices, how did you measure that? Was it really necessary in this case to determine the impedance that changes over period?
It depends what you want to do with the measurements afterwards. So you could say when you're measuring the subcycle impedance, then you see the whole variation range of the impedance. But when you measure the mean impedance over full voltage cycles, then you have the mean value. So it's a question, do you need this high time resolution of the impedance? So for example, I knew it from colleagues when modeling the impedance. So when you only have a look on full cycle impedances, then you have virtual, you could say, frequency couplings, for example. But you don't have this funny behavior of frequency couplings when you are measuring in really small sampling in between the fundamental waveform.
Okay, thank you. How could I imagine the difference in the measurement curves? I see your hand, Mr. Baumüller. You are the next one, please. And I'm very interested to know what is the difference. Would I see then impedance value bands if I have the measurement over the periods in comparison to the mean values?
So if we look, have only the averaging, and we see the impedance in parallel, it does not fit. If we make some points together and we make the measurements together in individual, and if we combine the average, it does not fit with the model. It is not only in parallel. If we make this three-dimensional over time and bringing sensor parallel points, then modeling and all fit together. So with only with the average point, we cannot combine and say that is the final result out of it. We need the three-dimensional to get the theory of parallel point and the point together with the modeling.
Okay, thank you. Are there more contributions?
Gerhard Hammer?
Yes, we did really tests concerning this. For example, with higher power, we did just a simple six-pulse rectifier. And usually at higher power, you do usually not have a six pulse rectifier on the grid because then you would affect grid codes and the current there is not sinusoidal, but the current there is when the diode of the six pulse rectifier opens, it's going up quite fast, then loading into the capacitor and then going down quite fast. And we did these measurements, let's say, over the whole period, and then also during the time when this huge current was going on, and the results were significantly different. And the background why we did this was the following. We were once driving at one of our customers, a power electronics device, and we were feeding it, let's say, out of a perfect power source in, let's say, really voltage mode. And then we found out the input stage of this device was destroyed. And we tried to model it. And out of this, we came then to the result that the standard modeling exactly of this situation was far, far away from what we measured in reality. But when we were then doing exactly the impedance behavior, let's say over this time period, we could really see why, let's say, this inrush happened and why this device was destroyed. And we cannot publish it because it was a test together with a customer, but we saw there that there is significant difference if you model it, let's say, as an average, or you really make a modeling with a time resolution in this case.
Okay, thank you very much. I see Mr. Waffenschmidt raised his hand. And
I wonder how relevant this problem with the time variant impedance is for real cases in the public power grid. I understand that it's relevant if you measure single devices and maybe even devices which consist of a simple rectifier and an LCAP. But in a power grid, usually even devices which have at least 50 watts or even more are required to have a power factor correction circuit to achieve a sinusoidal and well-distributed ohmic behavior. So my question is, how relevant is this problem with time-dependent grid impedance measurements for real measurement in the power grid and devices which are connected to the public power grid?
Yes, thank you very much. I think the question is if you need really a high resolution of a time-dependent grid impedance measurement, because if you use it is independent from the kind of measurement. If you apply it often enough, then you will get always a so-called quasi time resolution. But the question I think is, do you need really a very high resolution over one or some periods? That goes to the audience, please.
Yeah, that's exactly my question. I know that if you measure now and a minute later, things have changed. But do you really need to measure within a period a few times? Are there such large variations in a real power grid where the devices have to fulfill the relevant standards for power factor correction circuits?
Okay, Mr. Pammer.
Sorry that I always give the answers, but I agree with you. If okay. There are many, many devices outside, you have something like an average impedance. Mm-hmm. And for this case, for grid stability, it's not relevant. It's then relevant, for example, if the frequency band of power line communication is affected or not. But mm-hmm. if you have, for example, a wind park, where there are five or six turbines close to each other, then it's absolutely relevant.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That would be my answer. It really depends on case to case.
Okay. Okay. I think that would be a good topic for together measurement campaigns to compare under which conditions this is a relevant issue or not. That's a really nice idea. I think it's also interesting. That goes to Mr. Doe to collect.
Mr. Meyer. Okay, so thanks for the organization of this really interesting conference. So I very much appreciated the day. And it's a pleasure to try to organize the next one here in Dresden. Hopefully then the situation with all the traveling will have a little bit more relaxed. So let's see, we can just cross fingers. Regarding that, let's say relevance for the grid, you have seen in the slides from Robert Stiegler that most of the measurements that we have carried out usually show that variation within the cycle in the range of around 1 kilohertz. Yeah, so you measure at the transformer station, you measure at the junction box, you usually have it. And what was pretty interesting point for us, more from a research focus, is can you maybe determine the level of nonlinearity in the network by looking on this time variation in the impedance? So What is the prevailing circuit topology that is used? Are we already to self-commutated technologies? Then I expect we do not have such a, let's say, significant variation within the half cycle. While if we have significant simple line commutated technologies, which maybe even use no power factor correction at all, how we have seen by Professor Boommiller in his example, then you will have a significant variance. And this index that Mr. Stiegler has shortly presented is somehow like such an index of a level of nonlinearity in the network. So that's what we basically want to do with that. And regarding modeling, yeah, well, that's definitely a big challenge. What we thought about is if you go for a normal frequency domain simulation, like for harmonic power flows or so, for sure, it's very difficult to introduce this time-varying impedance. What we did was we look on different states within the half cycle and try to model this as a single, let's say, impedance configuration somehow. Because I think it goes even beyond this, let's say, talking about time-varying impedance is the question, does something like that exist at all? What is the terminology for impedance? Impedance normally is only defined for passive networks. Yeah. So is this an impedance? So, but if we look, let's say, time instant by time instant, we could maybe theoretically define somehow like a passive network that's behind it. Some with the capacitance connected, some not. Yeah. So this is still a very big challenge.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Meyer. I'm convinced that we have a wide field for discussion also for the next conference. I think, what's your opinion, Mr. Doe? Is it, do we have time for further discussions or?
Yeah, I think we could have 8 minutes more for
8 minutes, okay. Then. The field is wide open. Mr. Waffenschmidt, your micro is off, yeah, please.
Yeah, well, I have another question to the experts, which where I wonder if it is possible to measure. So we have loads, which are ohmic loads, like light bulbs and ovens, yeah. And we have loads which are power things, yeah, like power supplies for computer, whatever. If we have power sinks, they should even have a negative differential resistance. So that means if you increase the voltage, it will take less current and vice versa, at least at the fundamental frequency. My question is, can you see those things with impedance measurements?
Okay, Mr. Baumiller and Mr. Stiegler, raise his hands. Mr. Baumiller, please.
Yeah. For this case, the second time of technology with the harmonic power flows we developed, there we can directly see it. There we see it also this behavior on each harmonic order is, because we see there what it is and we can characterize it is. So that is a two different developments. The impedance, what we need on the one part, and the other one is the harmonic power flows where we have the angels and we can see what is the source, what is a load on it and how behave it, is it capacitive, is it reactive and so on. And this we can do also in the field that we are working with other ones to identify. Because normally your connection, and if you have only the impedance on one connection point, it doesn't help you because then you have to separate the networks. But with these power flows in all directions, we can also calculate it then in the one direction and in the other direction. And if there are power flows, we can also calculate the impedance in this direction. But that are combined technologies.
Yeah. Have you seen already those negative impedances?
Yes, we have.
Oh, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, cool. Thank you very much. I think it's very interesting to evaluate harmonic power flows in meshed grids outside the lab. That's very interesting. Mm-hmm. Mr. Stiegler, want you to add something?
So I just wanted to say, so for input impedance measurements at devices, so me for myself, I didn't see any negative impedances. So because mostly when you don't excite at this frequency too much, so when you are really in a small signal range, then you can say you more or less see only the input filter of the device. So, but so for some experiments, I also saw when you're looking really in the subcycle impedance with a really, really high resolution, then really for some milliseconds, you can see sometimes a negative impedance, but I don't know if this is measuring noise or if it's really there, but mostly you see only the filter.
Okay, thank you very much. Very interesting answers to this topic. I think this should also be investigated more in detail and compared with the different measurement approaches. And maybe we need, we all together need a special structure for the evaluation of different devices, different grid configurations, and different events in the grid. And in that way, I think it's a very nice idea to continue this conference as a conference event over the years, and maybe we can assign to every conference event a special topic within the next years. Are there more questions that should be answered or could be answered now?
Maybe one question.
Please, Professor Rocco.
Yeah, we just have a remark reacting to the question from Mr. Waffen-Schmidt that when you look at one device, you see something, but does it also occur on the whole grid? I cannot really say directly for distribution grid, but inside of a building, for instance, we have measured a building where there were 8,000 LED light drivers. And they, depending on the light that is needed, they go in a standby mode, and it's just rectify a bridge there, 8,000 of them. So altogether, things start to bring a very strong impact to the whole distribution system.
Thank you very much.
Okay, that's interesting, yeah, because each single device does not need to fulfill elaborate standards, but altogether they might cause some trouble, yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Do we have other topics, Mr. Meyer?
Maybe so, just to add, to follow up to Dominique, that what is particularly challenging, I think, in the network is too much similarity. Yeah. So if you buy, I don't know, 1,000 devices from the same type, you face usually more challenges than if it is of different makes. Yeah. If you have LED lamps of different makes, you usually have good compensation, all have a slightly different input impedance. But if they all are from the same type, it's usually the biggest challenge. And I also would like to really thank Mr. Pammer for this, let's say, encouraging request for looking also in standardization to input impedances. Yeah, so this is what I also try to pray more or less since several years, especially for the mass market equipment. In my opinion, this is urgently needed in the future, particularly for those with self-commutating technologies. But if you talk with normal manufacturers about that, not the ones with the big inverters or something, yeah, they usually resist, basically. Yeah, they don't. Well, we have enough standards and currents are enough, but this is not the case. So we know that from a PV inverter, you measure it under sinusoidal conditions. It has virtually no harmonics, yeah, maybe 50 milliamps at the fifth harmonic. You apply maybe 3% of the fifth harmonic, you get 1.5 amps just because of the bad design of the input filter. And this is what, in my opinion, has to be approached in the next years. That's so I'm completely on your line. If you need any help or support in convincing people, you can count on me.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much, Mr. May. I think that is a nice task for the Grid Impedance Association. Yeah. Mr. Müller has a contribution.
Yeah, I think it should be also the last question. Or the last contribution, maybe because of the time, Professor Schultz?
Yeah, I would say as long as we not look on the impedance, we only look on the voltage. But I think if we have to think on power, how much power is getting. If we have an impedance less than 1 ohm and we check power, it is not much voltage distortion. The voltage distortion is very low, but the impact on the grid is very high because it's a lot of power. So I think only to thinking in voltage distortion. And therefore we say the line impedance model is good because it shows the most voltage distortion. That not handles our EMC issues.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was a very nice closing statement. And with that, I would like to hand over to Mr. Doe. Thank you very much for your contribution and the nice discussion.